sing angels, and angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joy and strength. Why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? What the gladsome tidings be, which inspire your healing song? We sing, glory in excelsis Deo. Bethlehem, come to Bethlehem and see Him whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee, Christ the Lord, the newborn King. And glory in excelsis Deo.
Welcome, welcome, welcome to Spirit of God Fellowship. This is a day and a season, really, we're in a season of hope. No matter what it looks like on the outside, what it feels like on the inside, we're in a season of hope here at Spirit of God Fellowship. So we thank you and we thank Jesus for each one of you that's here with us this morning, sharing in this worship service that we have. So a couple of announcements. Our pastor, Brian Kamstra, is going to be bringing us a message today and next week. It's a two-part series on hope. And so that's what we're here for today, to hear God's word. And then as a reminder, we want to make sure that you don't show up to this building the Sunday after Christmas and the Sunday after New Year's. If you show up, you're on your own. Nobody else is going to be here. So we want to make sure that you remember that on your calendar. A special thing that we have this morning is that we have the entire Sutton family that's going to bring us a special reading of God's word, okay?
Watch and wait for Christ's coming. Light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love. Remember the promise of God with prayer.
We light this candle in hope.
Hear God's promise of hope from Isaiah 2, 2 through 4. In the days to come, the mountains of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills, and all the nations shall stream on it. Many people shall come and say, come, let us go to the mountains of the Lord, to the house of God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways and that we may walk in his paths.
For out of Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and shall arbitrate for many people. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you are so good, Lord, and we just thank you for this time together to prepare our hearts to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, Lord. We have been warned of a dark winter ahead, Lord, but we're so thankful that we don't have to believe it, Lord. You've already sent us the light. You are the light of the world. You are the light in the darkness, and we trust you, Lord. We recognize that although this Christmas may be a little different than we're used to, we pray that we would just take this opportunity to return to the real absolutes in life, and that absolute is you, Lord Jesus. You are absolutely our Savior. We have absolutely been forgiven. We have absolutely been redeemed. And you are absolutely our only hope. Thank you for your promises, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Belongs to you,
'cause you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Beautiful, 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 beautiful. Can we agree that our hallelujah, which means celebrate, belongs to the King of Kings, doesn't it? Only him. Man, oh man, thank you, team. Wow. Side of me that would like to just stay right there. The old worship leader in me. Well, good morning, Spirit of God. Good morning. Good morning. Thanks for coming to church this morning. I want to welcome all the visitors that are here this morning. We're so glad that you are here. We're so glad that we could all be here together. Man, I love being together, don't you? I say this all the time, you're getting sick of it, I'm sure, but my favorite hour of the week is between 10 and 11 on Sunday morning. It's my favorite hour. I love being together. But now we're beginning Christmas, and wow, this Christmas is unlike any Christmas we've ever experienced, isn't it? This year, COVID, social unrest, division in our country. By the way, we need to keep listening. We need to keep working to promote unity in this country, right? The election, the politics of this year, what a year. Oh my goodness. And so I'm thinking to myself, well, okay, here we are. We got 2 weeks to celebrate Christmas. That's what we're doing here for the next couple weeks. And it almost feels like even the songs we sing, those Christmas songs and the things that we say to each other, you really can't say them the same way. You know, it's like, I love that song, I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas. We all know, you know, Bing Crosby and singing that song. Man, I don't feel I can sing it that way. You have to say, it's more like I'm dreaming of a virtual Christmas, right?
Oh, and one of our favorite things to watch is Burl Ives on Frosty the Snowman. Have a holly jolly Christmas. You really, I don't know, it's holly and it's jolly as long as it's 6 feet apart, right? I mean, seriously. It's nothing is the same. Probably one of my favorite Christmas songs is Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas. I like the Carpenters version the best. But man, the mood that we're in, kind of where we're at right now, Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas just doesn't seem right. It's more like, Have Yourself a Merry Elfin Christmas, please. It's different, but you know what? Despite COVID, Christmas will always be about the gifts that we receive from heaven. It will always be about peace and joy and hope. And so this is part one of a two-part message called Hope Lives. I hope you can follow us through next week as we finish the message and have another special Christmas service. But man, I get it. I mean, we're talking about gifts from heaven, peace and joy and hope, but there are many here this morning that are struggling to find that peace and joy and hope. But see, I'm here to tell you that God has sent us hope in the form of a little baby born in Bethlehem named Jesus. Can I get an amen to that? And I love the Christmas story, I do. I love it. I love the Christmas story from the Gospels. I don't know about you, but I every Christmas I try to read Matthew's perspective, the book of Matthew. Matthew's perspective of the Christmas story. Mark's perspective of the Christmas story. John's perspective of the Christmas story, right? But my favorite is Luke. Luke 2. That's my favorite. Now, most of us have read Luke 2. Some of us have not. But if you haven't read Luke 2, certainly you've watched the Charlie Brown Christmas special when Linus comes out at the end, right, and shares Luke 2 with us, right? But see, I love Luke's perspective of Christmas. He talks about baby Jesus wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. Talks about Joseph and Mary. He talks about the shepherds tending their flocks by night. Luke talks about the wise guys, right? The wise men. He talks about the angels who proclaimed glory to God on the highest. I love Luke 2, but this morning, we're going to talk about the Christmas story. We're going to talk about Jesus' birth, but I'm going to share all this from heaven's perspective. I want to just stretch you a little bit and think about the Christmas story from heaven's perspective. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Philippians 2. If you don't have a Bible with you, that's okay. We're going to put it up on the screen here. Philippians 2, I'm going to start by reading verses 5 and 6. This is the Christmas story. You never thought of Philippians 2 as the Christmas story, but it is. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. In verse 6, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. I mean, read that. See, Jesus lived in heaven. Jesus was God. But Jesus didn't hold on to heaven, did he? That's what this verse is saying. I mean, think about heaven was a good gig for Jesus. I mean, he was there at the right hand of the Father and all the angels and the singing and the worshiping and all the stuff that's going on in heaven. But see, this is so amazing, because what that verse says is that Jesus was willing to let go of his grasp on heaven, that's what verse 6 said, so that he could come to earth to be born. Is that cool? Now, think about that one for a second. Now, this is just my crazy brain. You may not agree with some of this stuff, but this is just what goes on in my goofy brain. I don't think that Jesus was saying to the angels, I can't wait to get to earth to be born in that cold, dark manger with a bunch of animals breathing all over me. I don't think Jesus was saying to the angels before he came to heaven, before he came to earth, I don't think he was saying to the angels, I can't wait to be born. And then at 30 years old, my best friends in the world will be a bunch of loud, annoying fishermen that I got to hang out with 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I don't think he was saying that. I don't know. We'll find out later someday. I don't think that Jesus was saying, oh, I can't wait to starve. Because remember, when he began his ministry, one of the first things that happened is he went into the wilderness, had to go without food for 40 days. I'm not so sure Jesus was looking forward to that. I can't wait to starve. I can't wait to go without food for 40 days and 40 nights. I can't wait. Oh, yeah, starving is where it's at. Fasting is where it's at. Oh, come on. You don't like to fast either. I can't wait to be mocked. I can't wait to be beaten. I can't wait to be spit on. I don't think he was saying that. But do you know why Jesus left heaven? Do you know why? See, he was God. You know why Jesus left heaven? It's because, listen to me, he was able to look 2,000 years into the future to this morning, and guess what he saw? He saw you and me. He saw you and me. And so he left heaven with love in his heart. He left heaven willingly. He let go of heaven so that he could grab a hold of you and me. Can I get an amen to that? And I want you to know this morning, wherever you're at within your faith, I want you to know God loves you passionately. God loves you deeply. He loves you unconditionally. Is that good news? And friends, I hate to break this to some of you, but there's nothing you can do about it. There's nothing you can do about the fact that he loves you. You see, you can't run far enough from him. You can't sin too much to get away from the unstoppable, unquenchable, unconditional love of God. I love what Max Lucado says. Max Lucado is a famous Christian writer and speaker. He writes an imaginary prayer of Joseph, the earthly father of Jesus. And he writes, I love how Max writes. So this is his idea of a prayer that maybe Joseph prayed. This isn't the way I planned it, God. Not at all. I imagine family and grandmothers and neighbors clustered outside the door, friends standing by my side. I imagine the house, my house, erupting with joy at the first cry of the infant, slaps on the back, loud laughter, jubilation. That's how I thought it would be. It just doesn't seem right. What kind of husband am I? Did I miss something, God? This is not the way I wanted it to be. This is not the way I wanted my son. Oh, I did it again. I didn't mean to do that. I just forgot. He's not my son. He's yours. The child is yours. The plan is yours. The idea is yours. But forgive me for asking, is this how God enters the world? It's an imaginary prayer that maybe Joseph prayed. And then Max Lucado writes, maybe Joseph never prayed that prayer, but I'd be willing to bet that he did, and I bet you have too, but not outside a stable, You've prayed that prayer outside an emergency room or a courtroom or a cemetery. We've all asked the questions along the way, why? When your circumstances are stressful and they don't make sense, you can only do what Joseph did. He didn't let his confusion disrupt his disobedience. He didn't let the circumstances rob him of his peace or joy in that moment. You see, God's favor rests on those who follow him regardless of the circumstances. Oh, my goodness sakes. That is a mouthful. Don't worry, Jeff. I'm going to pick up my gum after it. The old podium that we had is caked with my gum. Just remind me. I don't want to give it to you. But Joseph's prayer. See, I got to believe that there are some here thinking this morning, okay, I hear you. Peace, joy, hope, love. I've heard all that stuff before. Hey, I come to church every Christmas and every Easter, and I've heard that stuff before. Well, I don't come to church all the time, and sometimes I don't go to church, but I'm here this morning. I'm sure there are some here thinking this. I'm here this morning, and I'm listening this morning. But see, if you knew what I had done, if you knew the type of life I've been leading, if you knew what kind of sin I was in, you wouldn't be so quick, Brian, to be telling me how much God loves me. As a matter of fact, if I'm honest, this is what some people are thinking. I don't feel his love. I don't deserve his love. And I don't think he loves me. There are some that are thinking that this morning, and you'd be wrong. You are wrong. Because, see, God says to you this morning, not just to you in the front row, not just to you in the back row, not just to you that are holding a Bible under your arm or have a Bible under your chair, the Christians. No. He's saying it to everybody here this morning, whether you're close to God or far from God, whether you sinned your whole life, you never sinned. He is saying to every single person here this morning, God says to you, I'm sending you hope. My son, Jesus, left heaven and came to earth, right? My son, Jesus, came to earth. My son, Jesus, was born in Bethlehem. My son, Jesus, let go of heaven. My son, Jesus, let go of heaven to grab a hold of you. And God says, Merry Christmas, everybody. Here's my gift of hope. What he says. To everybody. Oh, God didn't stop there. Verse 7 of the Christmas story from Philippians, but emptied himself. This is Jesus. Jesus emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. Hey, verse 7 is a part of the Christmas story, friends. See, God became a human being. He became just like you and me in the form of Jesus. Now, how in the world did God do that? How did he get, I'm going to make up a word. This is probably not a word, but how did God get his godness into that little baby? How did he do it? Do you ever think about that? I'm going to answer that question for you. I'm going to answer that question for you this morning. I have no idea. But I'll tell you what. I know why he did it. I know why. You see, there was this king that lived several hundred years ago. And he lived in a huge castle. He had thousands of people that lived outside the walls of the splendor of the castle. And he was a good king. One night, he was on the roof of his palace, And he was looking out and he saw this poor woman, this peasant. She was dressed in filthy rags. That's what all the peasants were wearing outside of the fancy castle. And she was walking to her little mud hut outside the castle walls. The king was struck by something, because this poor woman, this peasant, she was singing, and she was smiling. The king was drawn to her. And so every night, he watched her. He watched her night after night after night, and all of a sudden he thought to himself, I'm drawn to her. I have feelings for her. I can't believe it. I've fallen for a peasant. I could have any noble princess in the kingdom of my castle, but I've fallen for this poor peasant. What am I going to do? I want her to be my queen. And so he says to some of his advisors, he says, what am I going to do? I love this peasant. I want her to be queen. What do I do? And one of the advisors says, well, are you kidding me? That's easy. You're the king. You have all the power. Just make a decree that this peasant will be your queen. She'll have no choice. He said, no. If I did that, how would I know if she really loved me? Or if she only loved me because I forced her to? No, the king knew what he needed to do. He knew. And so the next morning at sunrise, nobody was up. The king went to the back door of the castle, took off his kingly robes, he took off his crown, he laid his scepter down, put on filthy rags, the same rags that all the peasants were wearing. And he left the splendor of his castle. He looked for his beloved. Soon he found her. And he declared his love for her. They lived happily ever after. Does this story sound familiar? And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger. Jesus was wrapped in swaddling clothes. Jesus was wrapped in strips of cloth. That's just a nice way to say he was wrapped in filthy robes, friends. Filthy rags. Our Savior, your Savior, my Savior, King Jesus came to earth to be just like us. Born in a barn, wrapped in filthy rags. You see, this was the only way for God and Jesus to prove his amazing love for us. Oh, I love it. I love the Christmas story. I love it from heaven's perspective. That's right. Jesus let go of his grip on heaven so that he could come to earth to grab a hold of you. Now, one more thing. This gift of hope from heaven, this is important. It goes beyond Bethlehem. It goes beyond Christmas. I want to read one more verse, verse 8 of the Christmas story, according to the Philippians. And being found in human form, Jesus, found in human form, Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. This Christmas story thing, it goes way beyond Christmas. See, Jesus didn't come to earth to die of old age. Jesus didn't come to earth to live a long life, did he? No. See, from the moment that Jesus was born, from the moment that he came to earth to prove his love for you and I, being born human, just like you and I. From the moment that happened, he had an appointment with the cross. And his whole life pointed to the cross. And he lived his whole life for you and I, looking at the cross. And he never wavered. And he did it for love, because it had to be done. Oh, hope. That's hope from heaven. And so, as we talk about the Christmas season this year, as we talk about the birth of Jesus, we need to realize, I want you to grab this, we need to realize as you're gathered around the tables or whatever you're doing, you can't just talk about the crib. We can't separate Jesus' crib from the cross. Can't do it. Can't separate the crib from the cross, because, see, Jesus was born in a manger. That was his crib. He was born in a manger so that he could die on the cross for you and me. Friends, that's part one. That's the gift of hope from heaven. Now, you're either in one or two places here this morning. There's really no middle ground. When you preach this kind of message, there's no middle ground. Maybe this is where you're at this morning. You don't have a relationship with Jesus, or maybe you don't have a good relationship with Jesus. But see, maybe this is where you're at this morning. He's reaching out to you. He's trying to grab a hold of you this morning. As a matter of fact, he's calling your name. He's been calling your name. You know who you are. He's calling your name right now. He's been calling your name. But you've been resisting his love, haven't you? You've been resisting his love. And so here you are this morning. You're feeling hopeless. You're feeling anxiety. You're feeling no joy. And the holidays are only making it worse. Can I get a witness? You know what? I got to tell you, if that's you, you're not alone. There's so many people that are in that same spot. He's reaching out to you. Grab hold of his hand this morning. We're not going to have a big show. You don't have to raise your hand. You don't have to come forward. Nobody knows. Just in your heart, if that's you, just grab hold of his hand. I want to promise you something. He'll never let go of your hand. Never. Receive heaven's gift of hope this morning. But there's others here this morning that you have a relationship with God. You do. Maybe it's not a good one. Maybe it is a good one. I don't know. But you've lost your joy. You've lost your place. You've lost your way. I'm sure that it's for many, many, many good reasons. Maybe that's you this morning. Well, tomorrow's December 14. We know that day. I do. 1 year ago to the day, tomorrow, God took our daughter home to be with him. What a week that followed. We gathered here the next day, remember? For those of you that were here, we had an emotional service together, and then the wake, mobs of people, the funeral. Such a beautiful, beautiful funeral. Matthew did such a great job. It was just a beautiful place. If not for the support of so many people in this room, so many beautiful brothers and sisters, if not for the support of business associates and friends, literally from all over the world, we wouldn't have made it. Aren't you glad that we have the family of God? Well, a week later, it's the 21st now, It was Saturday. I woke up, I got up, and I was dizzy. I thought, what in the world? I was dizzy. I went back to bed, and I said to Patrice, I am so sorry. I can't move. I'm done. I've hit the wall. I'm done. I can't do anything today. Or I'm afraid I'll just break down. And she said, man, that's okay. And I can't believe it. But she got up, and God's grace was on her, and she finished some Christmas shopping and things like that. I laid in bed, and I watched movies all day. It was great. The Great Escape. Sometimes you need to do that, don't you? That's right. Absolution. Watching mindless movies sometimes is okay. I had to preach the next morning. So I got up later in the afternoon and went over the message a little bit. And then I just went back to the couch. I just couldn't go. Couldn't do anything else. I turned on the movie channel that I've been watching all day. And the movie was The Runaway Bride. Starring Richard Gere, that dashing figure, Julia Roberts. Some of you have seen the movie. It's a story about a woman who never makes it to the altar. She has proposals, she's gonna get married, and many times, not several, many times, she's at the back and she's walking and she bolts, she runs, the runaway bride. She's famous or infamous. And so sure enough, she's getting married again. It's big news. And a New York magazine sends Richard Gere, a reporter, to follow the wedding. Will she run or will she not? I'm sure there was odds in Vegas about it. And sure enough, as Richard Gere is interviewing her, somehow they develop feelings for each other. But the wedding goes on, and there's the groom, and Richard Gere's in the audience, and the bridegroom walks and bolts. Richard Gere goes after her. They realize they're in love. I'm sorry if I'm spoiling the movie, gut, but they realize that they're in love. They decide to get married a couple days later, I think it was. Sure enough, now it's Richard Gere is the groom. They're in love. Julia Roberts is coming down the aisle. She bolts. They figure it out. Let me get to the final scene of the movie. Final scene of the movie. I'm watching. I'm just watching a mindless, stupid movie, trying to escape, not thinking anything. Final scene of the movie is a hill. Richard Gere, Julia Roberts, facing the minister, beautiful sunrise. If you've seen the movie, you know what I'm talking about. Beautiful sunrise on a mountain. There they are. Their backs to the camera. Minister does his vows, and then they turn to each other. The minister says, I now pronounce you man and wife. You may now kiss the bride. And on this beautiful hill with this sunrise, the camera pans to Richard Gere and Julia Roberts, and he kisses her. And you guys, a lightning bolt from heaven, a gift of hope came to me. I'm not kidding you. I'm not embellishing this at all. I saw Lindsay's face. Unmistakably, Lindsay kissing the groom, not Julia Roberts. And I felt the Lord say to me immediately, Lindsay's now a part of the bride of Christ. Lindsay was a runner. She's not running anymore. She's bumped into the arms of Jesus. She's happy. She's free. God sent me hope that morning. A lightning bolt. I wanted to share that with you this morning. A little personal, but I'm with my family, right? Well, some of you are here this morning and you've got a relationship with Jesus, but you're in a storm. Maybe it's a storm of health. Maybe it's a storm of a physical problem. Maybe it's a financial storm. Maybe it's an emotional storm. I don't know. Keep your eyes open this Christmas season. Watch a movie. Just keep your eyes open. Keep your ears open. I believe God's going to send the message of hope to every single person in this room this morning. He sends his gift of hope to everybody. Friends, hope lives. Don't you ever forget that. Father, thank you. Thank you for this day, this service, this family, these friends, brothers and sisters, new members, old members, visitors, it doesn't matter, sinners, saints, many more sinners than saints. I'm one of them. Thank you, God, that we're all here together, and it's good. We feel your love. And I pray, Lord, that none would leave here without receiving the message of hope from heaven. Hope lives. Hope lives. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Your baby boy would one day walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make child that you delivered will soon deliver you? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? That your baby boy
is Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great I am. Oh, the great I am. Oh, yes, he.
Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you so much. And now, God, I'm left with one conclusion. My only hope is to hope in you alone. So I want you to say that. My only hope is to hope in you alone. My only hope is to hope in you alone. That's all we have, and that's all we need. Jesus is the hope of heaven. As we've heard, he's been sent to us. And so I just want to leave you with this blessing. If you just want to reach your hands out and take this blessing from God. Now may God, the inspiration and fountain of hope, fill you to overflowing with uncontainable joy and perfect peace as you trust in him. And may the power of the Holy Spirit continually surround your life with his superabundance until you radiate with hope. God, our only hope is to hope in you alone. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming out. Have a blessed day. Have a blessed week. Thank you, Brian. Thanks for that message.